Hey guys, Merkeeves here, and in this video, I'll be checking out the i75, an all-polycarbonate, completely see-through keyboard from Monsgeek. Now, Monsgeek was kind enough to send the board out for me to check out and give my honest thoughts on, so all relevant links on where to get your hands on this board will be in the video description down below. But as usual, all thoughts and opinions about the product are always my own. Alright, so the i75 is a brand new keyboard from Monsgeek. Monsgeek being known for their Monsgeek M series aluminum boards, with their popular Monsgeek M1, M1W, M2, M3, and so on. But now they're back with a new board that's a little bit different from their recent releases, as this is an all polycarbonate see-through pre-built board. The board is available straight from Monsgeek's site priced at $69.99, available in a few different colorways: blue, pink, and purple. And now for the unboxing. Opening up the box, you get the board wrapped in some PE foam and underneath a plastic dust cover. We'll take a look at the rest of the board in a bit. Then as for the accessories that you get in the box, you get a rubberized coiled USB Type-C to Type-A cable, a switch puller, a keycap puller, some extra silicone mounting bits, some top mount screws and a hex key, and the user manual. Taking a look at the board, the i75 that I've got is in the pink colorway. The board itself is an all-polycarbonate, standard ANSI layout, exploded 75% keyboard with a color-matched volume knob in the top right side. The board has RGB lighting and has a pretty insane light show when the LEDs are turned on. Now, personal preference choice here, but I prefer turning the perky RGB lighting off and just having the side light LEDs on, because having just about everything on can be pretty harsh in the eyes. Anyways, taking a look at the sides, there's nothing much going on, but you can see all the metal mounting bits through the board keeping the screws in place. Really glad that Monsgeek opted for this, because this really helps the structural rigidity of the casing, because this gives the screws actual metal bits to bite into instead of digging right into the plastic compared to other cheaper boards. Taking a look at the bottom case, it's blank for the most part, but you can see a little Monsgeek sticker peeking out from the inside of the casing. Then it's got four rubber case feet. Then on the back of the board, on the left side, you get the USB-C port and the on and off toggle switch. Then on the right side, there's a storage compartment for the wireless dongle. When it comes to connectivity options, the board is tri-mode capable, making it usable wired, wireless via the 2.4 GHz wireless dongle, or by Bluetooth, connecting up to 3 devices. Monsgeek has some partner software for the board that lets you tweak things if you want to play with lighting settings or change up key mappings. You'll be able to find the software over on their website. Now checking out the keycaps, these are an all-polycarbonate OSA profile set with some silkscreen legends, which means over long-term use, the legends might end up fading. Overall, these are a really nice set that fit the overall theme really nicely. I'm just a little bit worried about long-term use cases. Now talking about the switches that came with the board are an upgrade of Akko's CS Crystal switches. These are the Akko V3 Crystal Pro switches. These are a 5-pin, all-polycarbonate housing linear switch with an 18mm long spring, a 45g actuation force, and a bottom out of 60g. The switch is using a long-pole dust-proof stem with a total travel of 3.8mm. The switches are factory lubed, but the lube job was only done on the railings, just like Akko's other Pro Series switches, making these switches good to use right out of the box. Then finally, for the general overview, the stabilizers that came with the board are PCB screw-in stabs and are factory lubed pretty nicely. In my testing so far, the factory lube job is nice and consistent, and I really only noticed a teeny bit of rattle on the right side of the spacebar, but it's pretty negligible. And now for a quick typing test, followed up by a teardown of the keyboard right after. Now to get the board open, there are a total of 10 hex screws underneath the board keeping the top and bottom case pieces together. Once those are off, disconnect the JST connectors for the battery and the daughter board. Checking out the bottom case, the board is using a 3000 mAh battery, and covering up a lot of the inside is a molded silicone piece in place of case foam. Then looking at the plate assembly, the board is gasket mounted using all these silicone gasket jackets that slide into gasket cutouts around the plate. The board is also top mountable using included top mount screws from the box. All you gotta do is remove the gaskets and screw on the plate assembly to the underside of the top case piece using the provided screws. I'm not really gonna be taking the plate assembly apart since it's all mostly standard inclusions. The assembly is made up of a polycarbonate plate, some EVA PCB plate foam, and an IXPE foam switch pad. The PCB doesn't have any flex cuts, has per-key RGB lighting, and uses Gateron hot swap sockets. And that pretty much covers the entirety of the board. Now here's a sound test of the top mount configuration, and I'll give my final thoughts right after. Alright, so the i75 is a board that I can see a lot of people, especially newbies, gravitating towards, because the all-polycarbonate see-through board honestly looks pretty interesting. While some others might think the full RGB light show might look kinda tacky, people wanting this in a fully RGB decked out gaming setup might really want this board to complement their desk setup. The switches and most of the stabilizers are factory lubed really well for the most part, making them good to use right out of the box, making this board super newbie friendly since there's really no need to get this thing open to retune things, unless you want to change up the acoustic profile of the board. Because sound-wise, the board does sound kinda thin and muted because of all the materials used. If you do want to make things sound significantly louder though, taking out the silicone sheet would be a big help, since that really opens up the insides of the case a lot. Other than that though, changing up the keycaps would also be a good move because the polycarbonate caps do sound pretty thin and hollow as well. Alright, so for closing thoughts, do I recommend the board at its price of $69.99 though? Yeah, I think it's a good pickup. I really think this board checks a lot of the boxes most people would want for a nice pre-built board that's ready to use out of the box. Subjectively nice aesthetics, a nice middle ground sound profile that's not too loud nor too quiet, a dedicated volume control knob, tri-mode wireless connectivity, and of course, RGB lighting. I think overall it's a really good value and would make a great board for newbies just entering the hobby. For the more seasoned keyboard enthusiast though, I'd probably look elsewhere unless you really just want to pick this board up for the aesthetics alone. Then by all means, go ahead. So yeah, with that being said, that's it for this video. If you enjoyed the video, please leave a comment and drop a like, as these videos take a lot of work. And if you want to see more content just like this, please consider subscribing, it really means a lot. All relevant links on where to pick up this board and other products will be listed down below. Thank you guys for watching. Till next time, Merkeebs out.